Good morning, everyone. Will everyone please rise for the playing of the national anthem and the reciting of the Pledge of Allegiance? Recite the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
On behalf of the congregation here at United First Parish Church, I want to welcome you all to this presidential wreath-laying ceremony in honor of the 252nd birthday of John Quincy Adams. And I should point out that the Navy always represents the Adamses in these ceremonies because John Adams was president when the Navy was officially formed. And John Quincy Adams, from the time he was Secretary of State, realized the importance of the Navy. And actually, Charles Francis Adams III was the Secretary of the Navy during the Hoover administration. So there's been a long history of the Navy involved here. And not only that, but President Johnson, and also President Kennedy, and Nixon, and Ford, and Carter, and Bush, were all members of the Navy. So we have that Navy connection. And I just want to mention that no one really was really any more into public service than John Quincy Adams. No one served in many capacities. And when he was president, this is what he said about government. It is the duty of government to foster the moral, political, and intellectual improvement of society. The end of government is the progressive improvement of the governed, which is something I think now, in this day and age, we start to forget. And Charles Francis Adams said this about his father. Amidst the storms of civil commotion, he nursed the vigor which serves a statesman and a patriot. For more than a half century, whenever his country called for his labors, he never spared them in her cause. A son worthy of his father. And at the funeral service here for John Quincy Adams, this is what the minister, Reverend William Parsons Lunt, said. We should view his long, useful, and illustrious life, recount the principal incidents of his career, and draw from his well-known character lessons that may be edifying. Where in history can you find such a glorious destiny assigned to a single life? And this church was gathered in 1639. And When we had the 200th anniversary in 1839, John Quincy Adams actually wrote a hymn for it. And this beautiful building, Stone Temple, was dedicated in 1828. John Quincy Adams wrote a hymn for the dedication service. Now, how many presidents, really, can you say also wrote hymns? It is amazing. And I should say, too, that Reverend Rebecca Froome, she is our 24th minister. She'll be given the invocation. But she is the very first minister that actually what we call settled minister, being a woman. And this would have delighted Abigail Adams. But it also would have delighted John Quincy Adams. Because that's what he said about women. I say women exhibit the most exalted virtue when they depart from the domestic circle and enter the concerns of their country, humanity, and their God. So, happy birthday, John Quincy Adams. We really are honored that you are a member of this congregation.
Will you lift your hearts and join me in a spirit of prayer, listening to these words of invocation for the language of faith most meaningful to you? Eternal presence, known by many names, known in many ways. We gather this afternoon in the walls of this stone temple, where so many have gathered before us to lift their hearts and open their minds to a larger reality. A larger reality, the mystery of creation that some know as God. A larger reality that we are part of an interdependent web of life, each of us connected one to the other. The larger reality that our communities, our democracy, is sustained through acts of service and civic engagement. We gather in these walls where so many have gathered before us, mayors and ministers, farmers and factory workers, presidents and poets and poet presidents, who have gathered to listen to the stirrings of the spirit, to articulate their beliefs and to speak their greatest truths. In our time together this afternoon, we turn our attention to our ancestors, to their life and their legacy. In our time this afternoon, let us remember that one day we too will be ancestors, that we are part of a living tradition, a tradition that affirms the worth and dignity of all people. A tradition that celebrates the possibilities of democracy. May our time together be blessed so that we might be a blessing to the world. Amen.
For those of you who have not been a part of the ceremony before, the ceremony will have three main parts, and I'm going to give you a little forecast of what those are before they begin. The first is to hear the words of the Adams themselves. We have always found here in our celebrations that that is the best way to tell the story of these very important people from this community and to our nation. And this year, we are not just recognizing, as Bill noted, John Quincy Adams, but one of his most important mentors and teachers, and the person who raised him primarily for the first 10 years of his life. That is his mother, Abigail Adams. For those of us who work at historic sites related to Abigail, this is the year of Abigail. As we sit here on July 11th, we are sitting almost exactly in between the 200th anniversary of Abigail Adams' passing in October of 2018, and the 275th anniversary of her birth, which is coming up in November of this year. So we will be hearing the words of Abigail and the wisdom of Abigail and perhaps a little bit of the intensity of Abigail as well. The second part of our ceremony is about acknowledging the legacy of the president in the world today. And we have a very special international guest here to speak with you about his work with regard to public service in the broader global community. And I'll let Jordi speak for himself. Last but not least, the reason why this ceremony exists, an annual presidential tradition of placing a wreath on the tomb of all deceased presidents on the anniversaries of their birth every year. As the only building to house the final resting place of two presidents, we have the privilege of holding this birthday party biannually. We do so for John Quincy Adams on this day, and we'll do so for President John Adams on October 30th. Enjoy the ceremony, and thank you for being here.
The great object of the institution of civil government is the improvement of the condition of those who are parties to the social compact, and no government, in whatever form constituted, can accomplish the lawful ends of its institution but in proportion as it improves the condition of those over whom it is established. Roads and canals, by multiplying and facilitating the communication and intercourse between distant regions and multitudes of men, are among the most important means of improvement, but moral, political, intellectual improvement are duties assigned by the author of our existence to social no less than to individual man. I am a man of reserved, cold, austere, and forbidding manners. My political adversaries say, a gloomy misanthropist, and my personal enemies, an unsocial savage. Yet, even with the knowledge of the actual defect in my character, I have not the liability to reform it. My good wife, Louisa Catherine, says, that I am a sturdy white oak, not to be crushed by these reptiles. In portraits, I have often been caricatured, even by painters of eminent reputation. I grow shy and reluctant at exposing my infirmities to these men and women of the palette and brush. Behind me, to my right, is a bust of me, executed by Hiram Powers, who was born up near Woodstock, Vermont. And I sat for Mr. Powers in close proximity to my 70th birthday. It was very clear to me that at that age, I had reached the allotted 70 that is given to us. Sculptor, thy hand has molded into form the haggard features of a toil-worn face, and whosoever views thy work shall trace an age of sorrow and a life of storm. And canst thou mold the heart, for that is warm, glowing with tenderness for all its race, instinct with all the sympathies that grace the pure and artless bosoms where they swarm. Artist, may fortune smile upon thy hand. Go forth and rival Greece's art sublime. Return and bid the statesmen of thy land live in thy marble through all after time. Oh, snatch the fire from heaven Prometheus stole, and give the lifeless block a breathing soul. Thank you.
The following is an excerpt from John Quincy Adams' essay, Society and Civilization, from the American Review, a Whig journal, Volume 2, published in 1845. The duties of man consist in alternate action and meditation, mutually aiding and relieving each other, and both directed with undeviating aim to the progressive improvement of himself and his fellow creatures. Heaven has given him in charge to promote the happiness and well-being of himself, his wife, his children, his kindred, his neighbors, his fellow citizens, his country, and his kind. And the great problem of legislation is so to organize the civil government of a community that this gradation of duties may be made to harmonize in all its parts, that in the operation of human institutions upon social action, self-love, and social may be made the same.
Abigail Adams to John Quincy Adams, March 20th, 1780. If you have a due sense of your preservation, your next consideration will be, for what purpose are you continued in life? It is not to rove from clime to clime, to gratify an idle curiosity, but every new mercy you receive is a new debt upon you, a new obligation to a diligent discharge of the various relations in which you stand connected. In the first place, to your great preserver. In the next, to society in general. In particular, to your country, to your parents, and to yourself. Justice, humanity, and benevolence are the duties you owe to society in general. To your country, the same duties are incumbent upon you with the additional obligation of sacrificing ease, pleasure, wealth, and life itself for its defense and security.
Abigail Adams to John Quincy Adams, Braintree, December 26, 1783. Glory, my son, in a country which has given birth to characters both in the civil and military departments, which may vie with the wisdom and valor of antiquity. As an immediate descendant of one of those characters, may you be led to an imitation of that disinterested patriotism and that noble love of your country, which will teach you to despise wealth, titles, pomp, and equipage as mere external advantages, which cannot add to the internal excellence of your mind or compensate for the want of integrity and virtue.
January 19, 1780. The strict and invaluable regard you have ever paid to truth gives me pleasing hopes that you will not serve from her dictates, but add justice, fortitude, and every manly virtue which can adorn a good citizen, do honor to your country and render your parents supremely happy.
From a letter written by Abigail Adams to her son, John Quincy Adams, July 21st, 1786. Get all the good you can and beware that you do no ill to others. You must be conscious of how great importance it is to youth that they should respect their teachers. Therefore, whatever tends to lessen them is an injury to the whole society. Besides, there is nothing which a person will not sooner forgive than contempt. If you are conscious to yourself that you possess more knowledge upon some subjects than others of your standing, reflect that you have had greater opportunities of seeing the world and obtaining a knowledge of mankind than any of your contemporaries, that you have never wanted a book, but it has been supplied to you, that your whole time has been spent in the company of men of literature and science. How unpardonable would it have been in you to have been a blockhead.
Good Good afternoon. Thank you for coming. Today, I will be talking about the term John Quincy used about the Mende trial before the U.S. Supreme Court, the thing that is not. Today, we meet to honor the birth of John Quincy Adams, July 11, 1767, and to welcome a friend from Spain who seeks to make a better, more artistic world, and a fairer one at that. How do we determine and engage positive service? How is J.Q. Adams a mentor? J.Q.'s grandson, the historian Henry Adams, wrote, "Chaos is the law of nature. Order is the dream of man." A few life events may enlighten the path of service which aspire to a more just and fairer society. I will focus on two events at either end of J.Q.A.'s life. But first, a name, his middle name, Quincy. J.Q.A.'s mother's mother was the daughter of Colonel John Quincy, who traced his roots to England and then the Massachusetts Bay Colony, who owned Mount Wollaston and whose name we share with a city of distinction, your fair city, Quincy. So remember, the Adamses married up to Quincy. On February 15, 1778, J.Q.A. first embarked on his navigation of civil service as he and his father boarded the frigate Boston. It was to be a shaping voyage. Abigail was reluctant to see J.Q.A. depart, yet while afraid of the sea, she acquiesced to J.Q.A. being his father's secretary at the age of 11, with concern for the snares and temptations of the old world, conceding that to exclude him from temptation is to exclude him from the world in which he is to live. And what an adventure the transit was. The Boston chased and captured a prize. The frigate was struck by lightning, which split its mizzen mast, and a sailor was killed with a direct cranial burn. John Adams wrote of his son, J.Q.A., "Fully sensible of the danger, Johnny was constantly endeavoring to bear up under it with manly courage and patience. Very attentive to me, and his thoughts were always running in a serious manner." Perhaps two things may have most influenced J.Q.A. in that voyage. For after the storm, he was to see his father, who sought to advise the captain on better cleanliness and order, order being one of the life themes of J.Q.A. Also, as his father had brought a French grammar book aboard, so Nicolas Noel, a French doctor returning from Revolutionary service, taught him near fluency in French in some 50 days. J.Q.A. at 11 already wrote and spoke Latin and Greek. So on arrival in France, he was better prepared than John Adams for communication and correspondence of diplomatic exchange. So J.Q.A. started national service at age 11. Near the end of his career, we learn about the thing that is not, a lie. The lie was the status, as slaves or not, of the cargo of Amistad. J.Q.A. stated that the Mende had been illegally enslaved. Their status was as those who assert their freedom and rebel, just like the founders of our nation. The core issue of the Amistad trial was that the enslaved Mende people had captured the Amistad from their captors and were attempting to navigate home and were intercepted and brought to New London, Connecticut by a U.S. coastal cutter. When Lieutenant Guiney encountered the Amistad, the Africans were in possession of the ship seeking to return home. They had killed the Spanish captain and cook. So blacks had overthrown their white Spanish captors. Were they cargo, pirates, or free men gaining their liberty? If they were property, as claimed by the U.S. government and the then Secretary of State Forsyth, a slave owner and our former ambassador to Spain, then under a treaty with Spain of 1795, so shipwrecked or disabled vehicles and cargo would be restored to either nation. As the Armistead had a false manifest or passport, as the slaves claimed that their human cargo was not, as the slavers claimed that their human cargo was not captured in Africa, so the slavers claimed that the Mende were not victims of the slave trade, which was now illegal. They claimed their cargo as Ladinos, the term for slaves who lived in Spanish territories since long before slavery had been outlawed. So were the Mende cargo, or had they justly sought a fair expression of their freedom? The case was being argued by the federal government as subject to the reciprocal treaty with Spain. So appeal by the Amistad Citizen Defense Committee would be argued ultimately before the Supreme Court, where five justices were slave owners. The case for freedom of the Mende people had been admirably developed by an attorney, Roger Sherwood Boldrin, and won in the lower courts. But now the case was appealed to the Supreme Court by the federal government. Here the Amistad defense sought out JQA as he had an unrivaled experience in the interpretation of international admiralty law. They sought his agency arguing the case before the Supreme Court. Before the Supreme Court, Adams stated, the Mende had vindicated their natural right to liberty by conspiracy, insurrection, homicide, and the capture of the ship in which they were embarked, and were of her cargo. So JQA argued that the Mende had asserted and reclaimed their inalienable rights as men. The local U.S. attorney recognized this principle. The Mende were of cargo, but not slaves. When the U.S. had seized the Amistad, it was under Mende command, so by rebellion they had earned their freedom. So JQA cited in February of 1841 the language of the Declaration of Independence to counter the Constitution, which still sanctioned slavery. The court ruled against the federal government's interpretation, stating that there does not seem to be to us to be any ground for doubt that these Negroes ought to be deemed free and that the Spanish treaty interposes no obstacle to the just assertion of that right. So we all may aspire to a fair and ever fairer world. So be vigilant for the thing that is not.
Thank you, Mr. Adams. It's a pleasure to be with you today and join with some distinguished platform guests. I do want to acknowledge Senator John Keenan, who, like the Adamses, was a Harvard grad, and like the Adamses, chose public service. Thank you, Senator Keenan, for being here today. I also want to acknowledge Kelly Caldwell from the Adams Natural Historic Park and Dr. Ed Fitzgerald from the Quincy Historical Society, who both work very, very hard each day to preserve and tell the story of not only the Adamses, but the great history of this great city. John Quincy Adams, when you think about him, and there's been much written about him, and it's been said that he probably had the highest IQ of any president by far, I really think of two words. One is intellect, and one is principle. You don't have to be a scholar to figure out the contributions he's made with his intellect. He probably greatest service was that of diplomat, Secretary of State, and he penned the Monroe Doctrine, which is still enforced today by our government. Incredible intellect. He was so far ahead of his time with industry and science, it was tough for people to grasp and follow him. And then principle. It's been said by David McCullough, the great author and national gem, he thought that John Quincy Adams enjoyed the public life most when he served in Congress after leaving the presidency. And I guess it's there, you would say, really where the principle comes to life. For those of you that don't know, there was a thing called the gag rule in the Senate that he argued against for 8 or 9 years before it was permanently lifted from the Senate rules. He and Abraham Lincoln, another congressman, voted against the war with Mexico. But his most, I think, worthy work was that of being against slavery and spoke so eloquently on the floor of the Senate. So, you know, today is a great day to remember John Quincy Adams. It's also a great day to remember the public service that is contributed by the Adams family generation after generation. I was elected as the 33rd mayor of the city One of the early mayors was Charles Francis Adams, a descendant of the Adams family, who after being mayor went on to serve as the Secretary of Navy under President Hoover. So, you know, we learn in many ways, but I think a great way to learn is that by example. And the Adams family has set the example, really set the standard of what it is to serve our country and our community as public servants. Happy birthday, John Quincy Adams. Thank you to our veterans. May God bless our veterans and God bless the United States of America. Thank you.
Better say I am overwhelmed because I have done nothing to be here. Nothing else but dream about a better future. Just as every person does every morning, pursuing little or big purposes. Because I have been invited to Quincy, the city of presidents, a symbol of democracy, one of the oldest cities in the United States of America. Here is where what came next began. And because I am among, I can say, friends that welcomed me in April with respect and love, believing in a crazy idea called First Saturday. Is it possible to provoke a global mobilization towards culture and social empathy? And you said yes. Yesterday, when I was preparing this speech, my eldest son, Eneko, little child of mine in the Basque language, came to me sobbing and said, "Daddy, I am the worst son on earth." "Eneko, why are you saying that?" I replied. "If you are the worst son on earth, that means I am failing doing my job as a father." "No," he answered, "this is not your job. Your job is First Saturday." I was shocked. "My dear, do you like First Saturday?" "Yes, Daddy, I love First Saturday, you know." "Eneko is only 5, and he barely understands what First Saturday is. He just likes it." Looking into his eyes, I told him, "Eneko, you sparked First Saturday. You were the inspiration for First Saturday. I am just doing it." He calmed down. Someday I hope he can understand. Let me tell you the story about First Saturday. In my previous life, I had a normal life. I had a good position in a corporate. I had a family, a long-term relationship, even 2 dogs. But I felt somehow empty. I entered a tough period trying to find myself. Then my parents died from 2 serious cancers. Also my grandma. I finished that relationship, and then I felt really alone. What is my purpose in life? That was the question. 2 or 3 years later, while being in New York, my current wife called me saying, "Honey, everything is okay. But when you come back, we will be free. Eneko is on his way." She was giving birth 2 months early. She suffered from a former thrombosis, which made it a high-risk delivery. After 18 hours of anguished expectancy of news, I was entering the plane to fly back when I received a text message saying, "Your wife is entering into surgery." And then I still remember that message on my ears saying, "Please, disconnect your mobile phones and keep them switched off during the flight." I was feeling alone again, and I thought, not again. After 2 hours of flight, and thanks to the kindness of the flight attendant, I entered the cockpit and received the news that mother and son were well. An echo was there. Then I sat back again, and while listening to music, I promised myself I would try to do something meaningful in life. I soon left my position in the business as usual and started First Saturday. During our lives, when we grow up, we forget what is really important, and we begin to care about secondary issues, properties, careers, money, power, fame, material, possessions. And we realize what's really meaningful again when we are in the last part of this theater called life. Nevertheless, during our lives, we receive a blessing that makes us reflect about what's really meaningful. It is our children. We dedicate our life to them. At the beginning, they are useless. We invest money even knowing they won't be profitable. We suffer with them. We care for them. They even invade our WhatsApp profile. And when the work is done, they quit. This is pure love. They represent what life is: future, hope, suffering, joy, desires, transcendence. Apart from the natural desire of perpetuity for the humankind, we only have children for one reason: for love. Children are the most powerful tool to build a better future. John Adams and Abigail knew it. One of the facts that impressed me about the second president of the United States of America is not that he traveled to Europe in 1789 seeking for inspiration, but the fact that he traveled with his son. Imagine for a while a trip to Europe in 1789 with a 12-year-old boy. Oh my God, Mr. President Adams, well done. In that trip, while he was getting inspired in the Basque region to help create the United States Constitution, he was at the same time building up the sixth president of the United States of America and one of the most ahead presidents of all times, John Quincy Adams. In the region of Biscay, we are honored that we were part of this inspiration journey. President Adams wrote about us: "Those people in Europe who have had the skill, courage, and fortune to preserve a voice in the government, Biscay in Spain, ought by no means to be omitted. While their neighborhoods have long since resigned all their pretensions into the hands of queens and priests, these extraordinary people have preserved their ancient language, genius, laws, government, and manners longer than any other nation in Europe. 230 years after that visit, we are here to reinforce this close relationship through this shared initiative called for Saturday. I bring a warm salutation from the Governor Unai Rementeria and the people of Biscay, wishing to maintain and enhance the friendship that the Adams family brought to our region. We are glad that First Saturday can connect Bilbao and Biscay with Quincy, Massachusetts, and bring together many other cities and regions, providing the world a breath of hope. Sometimes humanity only needs hope, courage, and a reason to meaningful things. Because we are living times of uncertainty, little cracks appear on our current economic and social systems. Economic cracks, we are polarizing the world. Climate cracks, the planet is asking us for a breath. geostrategic cracks, we seem to be more distant than ever in our own countries and among countries. Cultural cracks. Sometimes we are calling culture to pure entertainment, and we are relegating the culture to some elites because they say it's not useful or profitable. And knowledge cracks. In this dictatorship of the pragmatism, machines will soon replace many jobs as we know them today. What's happening? Yes, probably the world has never been as good as today, but we need to stop for a while and rethink our future. And for that purpose, we firmly believe there are two main pillars: culture and social empathy. What is culture good for? To offer a choice to learn how to live. It is a school for freedom, more important than ever, as we are living a time of a rare violence. Culture is life itself. It is through art and creativity we might be quickly aware of what life is. The goal of the art is to defend life. And what is the social empathy good for? To understand those who are in need. We must acknowledge that all of us will be in need sometimes during our life. And life is not about going faster and faster, but about knowing why to go. It's not about going farther away, but about where to go. It's not about arriving sooner, but about arriving together. Those elements inspire the ethos of First Saturday. Is it possible to create a global movement towards culture and social empathy? A collective celebration of art and culture? A participatory festival taking place in many communities, cities, and regions at the same time? And precisely the day after Black Friday, the maximum peak of consumerism. We must remark for Saturday is a positive movement. We are not against Black Friday. And in order to accelerate the human behavior toward culture on that day, what if the main accelerating driver was the support of social causes instead of any price reduction? Greediness versus social empathy, selfishness versus solidarity. This is the idea. The only requisite to participate into First Saturday is to support a social cause of your choice in three different ways. The first one, saying publicly to this social project, we are proud of you. Please keep on going. We need you. Recognition. The second one, allowing them 10 minutes before the show to explain to the audience what they are doing for a better world. Visibility. And third, dedicate part of the value, maybe tickets or donations, to the selected social cause funds. We started in Bilbao in 2014. We convinced around 20 choirs to perform on that day, supporting different social causes. And they decided to perform at the same time. So everybody was wondering, who is going to attend my concert if we all perform at the same time? It was, as always, a matter of faith. At the end, we did have more than 8,000 people who attended, generating the value of more than 8,000 euros for different social causes. It made sense. From then on, we started our journey. We set up the foundation, and we started to spread the message. At the beginning, and still now, it's tough. At the beginning, 8 out of 10 responses were no. But we did have yes. A violin player, a poet, graffiti artist, another choir, a theater. Oh my God. And then the first cities started to join in. From Bilbao to the city of Malaga in the south of Spain, and Huelva and the city of Santander, and then Bristol, the first city in England, and Scotland, the first nation that joined nationwide, and Lima in Peru, and more than 100 cities. And from 2019, thanks to you, United States is going to be part of First Saturday, because Quincy is going to be the first city in the USA to be part of First Saturday. Biscay and Massachusetts, alongside Scotland, are the three regions leading this positive worldwide movement towards culture and social empathy. And we welcome amazing First Saturday cities as a project to connect both regions, Biscay and Massachusetts, Quincy and Bilbao, and together invite many other cities and regions to this positive cultural movement with a social impact. Our vision is to create a day in the world, connect communities, cities, and regions, spark a global celebration around beauty and fairness. I ask myself, what would President John Quincy Adams think about First Saturday? I believe he would embrace the idea as you are doing. I believe that because while his peers were paying attention to pragmatic issues, he devoted himself to cultural issues. From translating classic works into English, to looking at European educational and cultural institutions as models for the United States, all the great leaders have respected and treated the art and culture respectfully. I believe that because he devoted himself to build bridges as an official ambassador of the United States in difficult times with plenty of challenges. And the most important thing, I believe that because he devoted himself to serve his community and the larger well-being of humanity, being one of the first voices against slavery. Justice before easiness, humanity before wealth, benevolence before pleasure. Only for that reason, John Quincy Adams should be considered as a reference and one of the best and most inspiring presidents of the United States of America. Worldwide leaders might learn from him and understand they have a mission broader than they usually consider, to serve their countries while serving the humanity. That is what John Quincy Adams did during his whole life. How important is to search for a purpose of life, a quest that can take the whole life itself. It is time for positive community leaders, for visionaries, for people looking beyond. Thank you, President John Quincy Adams, for inspiring and encouraging us to look for our own purpose. Thank you for serving the humankind through your country, your state, your community. Thanks for your legacy. And people of Quincy, thanks for being part of this amazing craziness called First Saturday. If you please, tell the story, inspire others, call your friends, send WhatsApps, share the initiative with all the cultural and social entities you can. Find bold philanthropies aiming to create a different day and a positive day. Go to media, write articles, make them be excited. Call the CNN, Fox, and the Boston Globe. Be ambassadors, invite all your sister cities to be part of it. But please, go to schools. Show your children there are other ways to create a better world. We need them. If you do so, they will be proud of you in the future as teachers, as fathers, as mothers, as local leaders. People of Quincy, thank you for being a founding mother of First Saturday in the United States. I am sure young Quincy Adams would have been proud of your vision and commitment, of your humbleness and kindness as human beings, for opening your heart to a simple man's idea coming from Europe in 2019, as we did in 1789. I don't know if First Saturday will grow or not, if we will be successful in accomplishing our mission, but I already know it is worthy. This is our quest for life, to make as many people as possible think about a more humanized future in this time of materialism, short-termism, pragmatism, and increasing global selfishness. To showcase the role of arts and culture and the heroic mission of millions of artists devoted to heal the world through beauty. To shout loud and clear that we are proud of thousands and thousands of social entities working for the humankind, and that we need them to build bridges among cities, regions, communities, races. Is there a more beautiful way than through culture and goodness? As a father, I would love that someday Aneko, Leo, and Paul can come and say that they are proud of Sayoa, my wife, and me. And people of Quincy, I would like you to know, as a founding city of First Saturday, we are already proud of you. From Bilbao, Biscay, thank you, people of Quincy. Thank you, states of Massachusetts. Glory and honor to young Quincy Adams. Thank you.
Four.